for God tonight. Glory to God. Glory to God. He is so awesome. Let's stand all over our feet. We're going to get started. We're going to go right into the Word of God. But before we do, we just thank God that you pressed your way. You just pressed your way. For those that are watching us via social media, thank you for pressing your way as well to even log in. So let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come before your throne of grace, thanking you and praising you, God, for who you are. God, you're the great and awesome God. You're sovereign in all of your ways. So, God, as we come before you on tonight, oh, God, to sit at your feet, God, we ask you to feed us, oh, God, tonight. God, impart wisdom into our lives tonight, oh, God. Open up the windows of heaven, oh, God, and give us what we need, oh, God, at this very hour, God. We thank you, God, for this midweek boost, oh, God. And so, God, we thank you, God, that we can go a little further, oh, God. God, we can go a little deeper, oh, God. God, we thank you for our pressing, oh, God, in the name of Jesus. So God, do it right now in this house, God. You know the need of every individual in this house, oh God. Open up their eyes and their ears, oh God, and their heart to receive your word on tonight, oh God. God, I am just a vessel that you're using, oh God. I thank you, oh God, that you've chosen me for such a time as this. So God, I ask you in the name of Jesus that you will come in and allow the Holy Spirit to rest upon this place tonight, oh God. None of me, oh God, but all of you be heard, God. All of you be seen. All of you be felt in this place on tonight, oh God. Holy Spirit, we ask you in the name of Jesus, God, let something be said or done, God, that will change the hearts of man, oh God, that will change us, oh God, and cultivate us, oh God, and transform our lives, God, to be used by you. And God, we just honor you. We give you glory. We give you thanks and praise for what you're going to do this hour, oh God, in the name of Jesus. God, we are in expectation of your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 Come on, give God a great big hand clap of praise. Come on, that's right. That's good, Mr. Sharon. Hallelujah. We have to shout even when we don't feel like it sometimes. We have to shout. You may be seated if you can. I know we've been talking about Women's History Month. We've been talking about perfectly imperfect. I know the first session was perfectly imperfect. We talked about Rahab, and then we talked about I'm chosen on last week, but we're broken. And tonight we're going to talk about the perfect potter and the imperfect clay. So we're going to talk about the perfect potter and the imperfect clay. We know that God is the potter. Christ is the potter, and we're the clay. So the question is tonight, and we're going to be in the book of Jeremiah, so you want to go ahead and just try to find it, but I'm not ready to go there yet. But we're talking about the perfect potter and the imperfect clay. The question is, are you willing to be put back on the wheel? That's the question I want you all to remember tonight. Are you willing to be put back on the wheel? Life happens sometimes and throws us off balance. Life happens and throws us off the wheel and get us off center. And there's some friction going on in our life that takes us off the wheel. And we're going to see that tonight. But the question is, are you willing to be put back on the wheel? Now, there are some things that are broken in our lives, and we think that we're unusable or unredeemable. There's shame happens and guilt happens in our lives. And so He don't want us to be guilty. He don't want us to feel shame about some things that's going on, but knowing that we are in his hands, everything is going to be well. Amen? So have life happened to you in a way that you felt shattered or destroyed or wrecked or even cracked? And you know the enemy will use any crack that he can get into. Any space that the enemy can find his way in, he'll find his way in. And that crack will become a big hole. And that big hole will become a pitfall. If we stay in that place, and we got to know that God said, listen, it's okay. I got you. So here is where the potter comes in. He's going to pick us up and he's going to put us back on the wheel. You ought to tell yourself, God, pick me up and put me back on the wheel. Yes. And the question is, are you willing to stay on the wheel until the imperfections have been removed from you? Are you willing to stay on the wheel? The first question was, are you willing to get back on the wheel? Now, the next question, are you willing to stay on the wheel for him to work out the imperfections in your life? Are you willing to stay on the wheel? Are you willing to go through the process of being molded, shaped into perfection? Because it's a process. So we're going to get on the wheel. We got to stay on the wheel. And then there's a process while we're on the wheel. And we're going to talk about this process tonight. But know that staying on the potter wheel is going to take some courage and determination, because it means we are willing to allow God to mold us into his image for his purpose and his desire. So we got to stay on the wheel. It's going to cause us to have some courage, and we got to have some determination. Sometimes you got to be determined to fight the enemy. You can't lay down and die. You got to fight him with the word of God. Amen. So many people don't understand the process of the wheel. The potter wheel is not to judge us, and it's not to punish us, but it's to form us into the masterpiece that the Lord has created us to be. It's not to judge us or to punish us, but it's to form us into the masterpiece that he wants to create us to be. And we're going to see in Jeremiah how Jeremiah said, listen, in Jeremiah 15, he said, I didn't participate in the wickedness of the people. He said, I was set apart because your hand was upon me. So many people don't understand that. So the potter knows in advance, before he puts the clay on the wheel, what it would look like. Now, I don't know if you ever just, while I was studying this, I had to look at some YouTube videos of pottery. I never just really just studied it or looked at it, but I looked at some videos of how the potter already has in his mind what he wants to create. And that's how a Christ is. The potter already knows in advance what, before he puts the clay on the wheel, what it will look like. He already knows the determination of the outcome of his usage. Jeremiah 29:11 says, I know the plans that I have for you. Plans for that you may prosper and be of good success. So in advance, he already know what he wants to do in our lives. He already know how he wants to shape us and mold us and make us for the kingdom. Ephesians 2:10 says, for we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do a good work, which God prepared in advance for us to do. So here we see, so God know in advance what he was molding, shaping you to become. The problem is there is some imperfection in the clay. There's some lumps and bumps in the clay. And here is where sin come in. Sin causes that friction in the clay. And we're going to see that when sin comes in, sometimes it takes us off the wheel. It gets us off balance. Amen. So a good example of that is in Luke. We talked about the prodigal son, how the father had already had a plan for the son. He already had the son inherited, already planned out. But the son says, give me mines now. He don't want to go through the process. He said, give me mines now. And so when the father didn't fight him, because see, God is not a God. God, he's not going to force himself on you. When the father allowed him to take his inheritance and go on to do what he want to do, guess what? The son found himself in a place that he need to go back home. And he had to go back and get on the wheel. See, sometimes we move on our own and mess some things up. And that's what happened to the prodigal son. He got off the wheel, but then God said, I'm going to put you back on the wheel and gave him another chance. So we're going to talk about the perfect potter, which is Christ, which is the one who makes and forms the imperfect clay, which is us. And Genesis 2:7 says, the Lord formed the man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And the man became a living being. He became. We are becoming who God has designed for us to be by his molding and his shaping. The man became. So here we see that the clay is formed from the dust of the ground, and we know that the clay has some imperfection. I don't know if anybody really seen clay, but down in my mom's hometown, down in the country, there's a lot of red clay and red mud. And there's a lot of imperfections in there. There's a lot of rocks and all kind of stuff. So he can't form you to what he wants you to be with all this mess on the inside of us. Okay? So he got to do something. He got to mend some things and mold us and do some pressing to get some imperfections out of our lives. So let's go to Jeremiah 18. That's where we're going tonight. Jeremiah, the 18th chapter. verse 1, and we're going to be in the New Living Translation, Jeremiah, the 18th chapter, verse 1 and through verse 6. And it reads, "The Lord gave another message to Jeremiah. He said, go down to the shop where the clay pots and jars are made. I will speak to you while you are there. So I did as he told me and found the potter working at his wheel. But the jar he was making did not turn out as he had hoped. So the potter squeezed the jar into the lump of clay and started again. Then the Lord gave this message to Jeremiah. O Israel, can I not do to you as the potter has done to his clay? As the clay is in the potter's hand, so you are in my hand." So here he's talking about Jeremiah and talking about the people of Israel and the nation of Judah, how they were so disobedient, y'all. They were doing all kinds of stuff. They were worshiping false gods. They were doing so much to the point where he told Jeremiah, don't even marry and have no children with these folks. Just don't even do it. Don't even connect yourself with these people because I'm going to deliver you. So here he said, and that's what's happening today, even in our nation now. So much is happening to the world now. Some of the things you hear, I was sharing with somebody the other day, nothing I hear surprises me anymore. Nothing I hear surprises me anymore. What I'm telling you, when they say, well, this is happening, somebody's doing this and the world is doing it, it don't even move me, because in the book of Revelation, you said all these things going to happen. So these things was happening in that time, and they are even happening in this time. So the process was, here is where God gives Jeremiah a detailed description on how he's going to work through our imperfect lives. He told Jeremiah, I'm going to put you on the clay. And this is what I want to do with the nation. I'm going to put them on the clay. But repentance has to happen. I'm not going to save you if no repentance don't take place. So in verse 4, that's the verse I want us to focus on tonight the most. Verse 4 says, but the jar he was making did not turn out as he hoped. Verse 4 tells us that what he was making didn't come out the way he desired it. So the potter started over. God doesn't throw us away when we mess up or we sin against him. Grace comes in. See, the potter could have took that clay and throw it away and started over with another piece. But he said, no, grace comes in. So what he does, he put us back on the wheel and continue to work on us until we become who he desires us to be. So he's going to work on us until we become who he desires us to be. Sometimes we fall short, but it doesn't mean failure. It doesn't mean finalization, because we've fallen short. How many are thankful tonight that the potter just don't disregard us and throw us away? How many know that we messed up so many times, we got off the wheel, we got off balance, and he didn't just throw us away, but he redeemed us. He gave us another opportunity. He's still reshaping us. He's still repairing us. He's still revamping us, and he's still changing us. Just like we talked about last week, change can happen in our lives. We have to be transformed. Our mind has to be transformed. Our thinking has to be transformed. We can come in here and put on a facade, but if change don't happen, guess what? You're doing the same thing. You're just spinning in circles, doing the same thing, but expecting a different result. Even though there was a delay, because see, what happened is when the clay wasn't right, he had to take it off and start it over. That means there was a delay. But it wasn't a denial. It wasn't a rejection. But because he had to start it over. So just because you have to start over in life sometime, don't mean that that's the final end. Okay? Thank God that you can start it over. Thank God that he's a God of another chance. So don't fight the process to be perfected for your purpose or destiny. So point number one, I'm going to got 4 points. The potter chooses the clay. You are the clay. You ought to say, I'm the clay. God did not choose any old clay. He chose you, one that is usable and pliable for service. Now, I know sometimes we look in the mirror, and I'm guilty. We look in the mirror, we look in the mirror, we look at ourselves, we look in the mirror, and we see all these imperfections. But see, God don't look at us the way we look at ourselves. God don't look at us like that. But God said, I can work on that. I can reshape that. I can make that into what I desire it to be. And sometimes we look it up clay and say, I don't like this and I don't like that. But you need to remember, you got some bumps and bruises and lumps in your clay. You don't need to be looking at no other clay talking about what they ain't got going on. You don't need to be looking at no other clay and trying to point out they issues when you got some rocks in yours. Okay, you ain't smoothed out. You still bumping and lumpy. Okay, so don't look at the other clay. So be mindful of your own imperfections, okay? So out of everybody in your family, you ought to think about that. Everybody on your job, God skipped over all those people that probably was more qualified. But he said, I want you because I poured the oil on you. There's the oil on you. That means you have been called. You have been called for service. So the potter chooses the clay that shapes it into the image that he desires. Every situation, every circumstance is a part of the shaping. Everything that you're going through, everything that you've gone through is a part of the shaping. It's not by coincidence, it's not by accident that you are facing what you're facing or have faced what you faced. Because guess what? What you have, what used to be, is no longer. See, what used to throw you off balance, don't throw you off balance no more because he had put you on the wheel and shape you. What used to bother you don't bother you no more because there was some shaping going on in your life, okay? So it's not by accident that you are at the position or the place that you are right now. The potter not only chooses the clay, but he has to separate the clay, okay? There can be no molding or no shaping done without separation. So as I was watching these YouTube videos, when the potter actually get the clay, he cuts some of that clay off. He separates some of it from each other. So there has to be some separation in your life. All of us are clay. He didn't take all of us and put us on the wheel at one time. He had to separate us because each one of us got a different purpose. Each one of us got a different plan. Each one of us got a different end. So what he's shaping me to be, he's not shaping you to be. Because you probably can't hold what I can hold, and I can't hold what you can hold. So don't think your shaping is imperfected because of where you may be at in your faith walk with Christ. Okay? So because everybody has to be shaped the way he has designed for them to shape. So to remove the imperfection, there has to be some detachment. He got to cut some things off in your life. He got to cut you off from some people, some places, and some things. He got to cut off some things in your life to get you where he wants you to be. So you need to get comfortable enough that to know that because you've been chosen, you're going to be separated. Because you've been chosen, you can't go where you want to go. You can't do what you want to do. You can't connect with who you want to connect with. Because you're going to stand out like a sore thumb because you don't fit in. You don't fit in with that. You don't fit in with that. You don't fit in with them. So understand the separation is necessary in the process. So, and the reason being because you got a call on your life. There's some oil on your life, even if you have not accepted the call. And let me say something about the call. Because when people talk about you got a call on your life, people always think you got to be behind the podium. That's not always the case. You don't have to be in a prophet, evangelist, a prophet, a teacher. That is not always the case. You are called for whatever purpose that God has planned for your life. No matter, you may be called to shine the light on in your workplace. Okay? So don't think about the call being behind the pulpit wearing a collar, because that's not always the case. So the potter chooses the clay. Along with choosing comes separation because you have oil on your life. Second point, the potter is spinning and it always at work. So as I was watching this video, the hands and the feet of the potter is always moving. It's always moving. And as his feet is pumping, the clay is being rotated. Okay? While he's working, it's a constant spinning. He's constantly spinning us. He's constantly spinning us. And the clay is spinning as he's working. Now, this may be the picture of your life. You may seem like my life is spinning out of control. In my marriage, with my children, in my finances, on my job. this is what's happening. But he said, while you're worrying, he said, I'm working, because he's spinning. His feet still moving. His hands still going. He's still shaping. He, guess what? You ain't turning out the way he wants you to turn out. He take you, he put you back on the wheel again. Put you back in the center so he can keep you balanced. And he keep working. His hands is on the inside of the clay, and he's still working, okay? So don't think your life is out of control just because. He's working it out on your behalf. So I know you may ask the question, how long am I going to continue to go through this over and over and over again? The joy is, no matter how long you're going, how long this thing is going, how long you're spinning, know that the potter is working. And he's changing you, not your circumstance. He's changing you. Because guess what? If he changed, and I'm trying to stay balanced at the same time, but I want my feet to be moving, because that's what the potter does. He's changing you, not your circumstance. Because, see, you asked God for that job. He gave you that job. Now, God, I can't stand these people in this job. He gave you another job. You can't stand the people in that job. Because guess what? It ain't the situation, is you. See, he got to work on you. So he's still working. He ain't going to change the circumstance. I want to change you, the clay. I want to change you. I ain't trying to move you. I'm trying to change you. So the word of God said, greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Okay? So be patient. There's a song that said, please be patient with me. God is not through with me yet. I'm a work in progress. How many is a work in progress? He's still working on me. So he's still spinning some things out of your life. He's still shaping you. He's still fashioning you. He's still forming you. He got you at the center of the wheel, and he is the center of the spinning, because he wants to keep you balanced. Whatever you're facing, he wants to keep you balanced. In 2 Corinthians, when I read this, I said, God, I can see you working while I'm reading this. 2 Corinthians 4th chapter, verse 8 said, we are hard-pressed on every side, but we are not crushed. We are perplexed, but we are not in despair. We are persecuted, but we are not abandoned. We have been struck down, but we are not destroyed. Therefore, we do not lose heart. Though outward we look a mess. Though outward we are in despair. Though outward we are wasting away. Though outward you look at me and you judge me by what I look like on the outside. But inward, I'm being renewed every day. Every day. If you go back and look at some potter videos, their feet is moving. And their hand is on the inside of the clay. The potter hand is on the inside of you. He's constantly working. He's constantly doing a process in you. No matter who you are, no matter what your age is, no matter what your circumstance are, you got to stay on the wheel. You got to stay on the wheel. But to stay on the wheel, you got to yield to the potter's touch. That's my point number three. You got to yield to the potter's touch. Here we see the potter simply removes the clay, that was in verse 4, and takes out the imperfection. He's kneading it, K-N-E-A-D. He's applying some pressure right here. He puts it back on the wheel and works with it again. He got to apply some pressure in your life sometimes. You got to be released. There's some release that has to take place. There's some force that has to be done to get out this bitterness in your life, to get this anger out of your life, all this hurt. He got to apply some pressure. During the pressing, what God is doing, he's allowing some things to come to the surface. The more he's pressing, the more you're coming to the surface of who he wants you to be. See, he's trying to eliminate some things. Because, see, once you go through the fire, that's it. But he don't want you to go through the fire with the imperfections within you. So you got to yield to the submission of God. You got to give in and submit and surrender to him. That's how God works with us. He's persistent, but we have free will. He said, I'm going to work with you long as you're pliable. But it's free will. You can make the decision to reject the will. You can come off the wheel, as some of us has done. And guess what? That's a bad decision to come off the wheel. That's a bad decision to be out of the hands of the potter. With that decision, our lives become broken and cracked. We come fragmented. We come twisted when we come off of the wheel and we reject the works of God's hand. Here is where we are unable to be used by God because of our decision to reject the potter's touch. Yes, we can reject the working of the potter, but ultimately, we'll suffer in the end. So we got to yield to the potter's touch. We're not going to be like the people of Israel and Judah. Those people, when I read the book of Jeremiah, I read it all the way from the first to the 20th chapter. Some of the stuff those people were saying out their mouths, I was afraid to. I said, God, help. They was trying to stone Jeremiah. They was trying to destroy him. In other words, telling him to shut your mouth. We don't want to hear nothing. You got to say nothing. We're going to find us somebody else to talk to us for our own God. And God said, nope. But God told him right here in chapter 18, he said, guess what? If you would possibly turn, I can take you and do what the potter did. Put you back on the wheel and not destroy you. But also he said, if you don't repent, I'm going to destroy you. So guess what? We're not going to reject the clay. We're going to be obedient and walk into the will of God that God has planned for us. We're going to be workable and pliable in the potter's hand. And verse 4 again, the clay is marred. We're defected vessels. Sin is in the clay. The clay cannot fix itself. We cannot fix ourselves. We cannot redeem ourselves. We cannot repair ourselves. We need the touch from the potter. We cannot save ourselves. And that's what the children of Judah was thinking. They can do it on their own. They were doing the things the way they wanted to do it. You know, people like the young folks say, I'm going to do me. You can't do you because you was chosen. You just can't do what you want to do. So the same way with Adam, after Adam had sinned, he couldn't save himself, which is the same way we cannot. We can't do anything without the potter. So as we yield to God, that's when the shaping takes place. See, there's no friction. When you yield to God, there's no friction in the clay. It becomes soft and manageable. And he can begin to mold it and do what he wants to do. He can begin to transform it and change it. But as long as you push it back, guess what? He can't use you. He can't work with that. Amen. And he's not going to force himself on you. He's not going to force himself on you. Everything that God forms, he fills with his purpose. Everything that he forms, he fills it with purpose. Remember that the potter hand is on the inside of the vessel. And that's the filling of the Holy Spirit. My point number 4, the potter's grace. The potter's grace. Verse 4 said the clay was marred, which that means we got some blemishes in us. We're flawed and we're disfigured. So what did he do? He gave us another chance. He gave us another chance and another chance and another chance. He did not pick the clay up and throw it away. He gave us another chance. And he said, I'm going to do it over and over and over again until you get it right. I'm going to change your life. I'm going to give you another chance. As long as you are yielding to me, I'm going to give you another chance. As long as you're being submissive to me, I'm going to give you another chance. Guess what? Even though you may not come out the way I want you to come out the first time, there's a second time, and there's a third time, and there's a fourth time, and there's an abundance of God's grace every time. Every time. So in 2 Corinthians 12:9 says his grace is sufficient, for he is made perfect in our weakness. God is made perfect in our weakness. So where we're weak and faulted and fail, guess what? We are being perfected in him every time. Just remember, he don't throw you away. He don't throw you away. Thank you, God. He don't throw us away, but he's putting us back on the wheel. So the question is, are you willing to get back on the wheel? Are you willing to stay on the wheel? And are you willing to go through the process of what it takes to be on the wheel? Because it's some work to be on the wheel. Because your flesh wants to do things the way you want to do it. Sin feels good to the flesh. Don't let nobody tell you different. It does. Wrong feels good to the flesh. Amen. So I want you to keep pressing. Keep allowing God to shape you. Keep allowing God to mold you and mend you and restore you. Guess what? Get back on the wheel. Stay on the wheel. He's going to put you in the center of it so you don't fall off. And if you do fall off, guess what? He's going to pick you back up. He's going to dust you off. He's going to, guess what? He's going to press. He's going to put some pressure on you and put you back on there. So I want to encourage you tonight to yield to the potter's wheel. Even in your imperfection, I want you to yield to the potter's wheel. Don't have that friction in your life. So God, I don't know what you're doing. God, I don't like what I see in my life. But I trust the process, because it's a process. When you get on the wheel, when the clay get on the wheel, it just don't happen. There has to be some forming done. There has to be some shaping done. It's patience on the wheel. You got to be patient to get on the wheel. You got to be determined. Amen? So thus saith the Lord. And I want to share this with you, because these are some things that God dropped in my spirit about being on the wheel. Thus said the Lord, this is on the wheel. This is the place. On the wheel is where I'm going to mend you and conform you into my image. On the wheel is where all the impurities will be destroyed. On the wheel, all your blemishes, your bruises will be erased. On the wheel, all your rough edges will be smoothed out and the brokenness will be restored. On the wheel is where your old mindset will be transformed. On the wheel, your afflictions, your trauma, your misfortunes from your past will be erased. On the wheel, you will have new dreams will be brought forth on the wheel. You will be renewed. You will walk in integrity, and you will walk in maturity. All these things, these are the promises of God if you stay on the wheel. These are the promises of God. He said, I'm going to give you a new mindset if you stay on the wheel. He said, I'm going to birth some things on the inside of you if you stay on the wheel. I'm going to transform some things in your life if you stay on the wheel. So I want to encourage you all tonight. You are in the potter's hand. And he wants to put you back together again. Those fragmented pieces of your life, he wants to put you back together again. Just because you feel like you're broken, don't mean that it's over. He wants to pick those pieces up, and he wants to put some pressure on it, and he wants to form you into the image that he has designed for you to be. So stay on the wheel. You ought to tell your neighbor, stay on the wheel. So if you've gotten off, all you have to do is repent, and you can get right back on the wheel. Amen. Come on, let's give Jesus a great big hand clap of praise. Hallelujah. He wants to fix every imperfection in your life, and the only way he can do that is by staying on the wheel. You got to stay on the wheel. That nothing you've done is so bad that you can't go back and get in the potter's hand. Nothing, absolutely nothing that you've done. Don't allow your past to keep you off the wheel. You are shapeable. You are usable. You can be redeemed. We can be redeemed. We can be redeemed. We can be redeemed. Grace has come in and covered all of that. Like we said last week, the blood covered that. And the blood gonna cover everything else that we may face in life. Everything that we face in life, the blood has already taken care of it. Amen? Amen. So let's stand all over this place. I see that you already have given your offering. But those people that are watching us via social media, you can give by texting the word give. And you can use Cash App, $LoveTLDC. So I want to encourage us, no matter what is going on in our lives, no matter what is going on in our lives, no matter what is going on in our lives, the potter wants to put you back together again. All you need to do is yield to the potter's touch. Stay on the wheel. If you off, get back on. And once you get on, stay on there. Amen? Amen. Lift your hands to heaven. Sister Darlene, will you hold the basket up so we can bless the offering? Thank you, Lord God. Thank you, Jesus. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for this offering, God. We ask you right now in the name of Jesus that you will bless it, God. Multiply it. Multiply our seed sown on tonight in the name of Jesus. God, you said in your word that you will open up the windows of heaven and cause us blessings, God. We won't have room enough to receive. So, God, we receive your blessings tonight, God. 100-fold return. We thank you, oh, God, that this house, God, is a house that can give, oh, God. That a house that we can, God, be lenders and not borrowers, God. And we thank you, oh, God, that what you've already done in this house and what we're expecting you to do in our house and continue to do in this house. God, we ask you right now in the name of Jesus that you would, Lord, increase us in every arena of our life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Come on, lift your hands to heaven. Father, we thank you tonight. God, we thank you, God, that you are the potter and we are the clay. God, we ask you right now in the name of Jesus that you will forgive us of all of our sins. Anything that we've done, oh God, anything that we've said, anything that we were involved with, oh God, that has taken us off the wheel. God, we ask you right now in the name of Jesus that you will let grace abide in us tonight, oh God, that you will put us back on the wheel, oh God. Spin us, oh God. God, mold us and make us, oh God. Apply the pressure of life, oh God, to us. God, that we can shape us to be who you have called us to be. God, we ask you right now in the name of Jesus. We submit to you, oh God. We surrender to your touch, oh God. We yield to you tonight. God, we won't pull back, oh God. We won't live in bondage, oh God. We won't live in sin. We won't live in darkness, oh God. But we come to the marvelous light. And God, we ask you in the name of Jesus that you would take our lives, oh God, and begin to mend it, oh God. Begin to transform us, oh God. Thank you for being a God of another chance and another chance and another chance. God, thank you that you give us the opportunity to get it right each and every day. God, your grace and mercy is new every morning, oh God. So God, we thank you, God, for your grace. We thank you for your mercy. And God, we ask you right now to purify our hearts, oh God. Every impure thing in our lives, oh God, we ask you to strip us right now in the name of Jesus. Strip us, oh God, of sin, oh God. God, anything that keeps us away from you, everything that keeps us out of your will, oh God, we don't want to partake in it, oh God. And God, we thank you for the Holy Ghost that leads us and guides us and directs us, God. Allow the Holy Ghost to come up on the inside of us, oh God. God, we thank you that we're on the wheel. And God, we won't come off until you've done a finished work, oh God. And that's when we'll see you in eternity, God. God, that's when we'll meet you face to face, oh God. And so, God, we ask you in the name of Jesus, every person that's in this place, every person that's listening under the sound of my voice, God, whatever they may be facing, oh God, whatever situation, God, God, what life may be happening for them, oh God, and they seem like it's out of control, know that you're working, God. While they're worrying, God, you're working. God, you know that you are working on their circumstances. You're working on their situations, oh God, and you're purifying them, oh God. God, you're changing them, oh God, and not their situations. God, you're giving them the ability to stand, oh God, in the fire, God, and not even get burned. God, we thank you, oh God, that you're fixing us, oh God, that you're molding us and you're making us, oh God. God, creating us a clean heart, oh God, and renew the right spirit on the inside of us. Do it in us, God. And help us, oh God, be a light to someone else, oh God, that don't know the way. Help us be a light, God, to someone else, God, that is living in darkness. Help us to be a light, oh God, to someone else, God, that has gone fallen off, oh God. Someone else has, Lord, fallen off, oh God. Help us to be the light that helped them get back on the wheel, oh God, in the name of Jesus. So, God, we just thank you tonight. Have your way in our lives. Do what you want to do with us, oh God, in us and through us. We submit to you, oh God, and we'll be careful to give you the glory, the honor, and the praise. In Jesus' name we pray, amen, amen, amen. Give God a great big hand clap of praise. Hallelujah. We thank God for our pastor in the house tonight. We thank God for all those that came out. Is there any special prayer requests in the house tonight? Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All is well. Amen. Lift your hands to heaven. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. In Jesus' name, you are dismissed. God loves you, and we do too. Be blessed. Amen. Amen. Stay on the wheel.